Good evening. I'm Kevin T. Sabu, and I'll be a moderator for today. Thank you for joining with us tonight. We are glad that you're part of our webinar series. Nauticum's Event Management Private Limited is a student-led initiative run by a team of students from various universities in Australia, Canada, India, Philippines, UK, and USA to facilitate dialogue on some of the most important issues that third world is faced with right now. The vision behind the Secret of Circle webinar series is to set up a deliberative space that will enable conversations to occur without a power hierarchy, offering space for different voices to be heard, stimulating the form of a circle that stands for unity, harmony, and equal consideration of all participants. We believe that platform will create a free flow of ideas that will allow the youth to ask relevant questions and embark on a solution-seeking journey. Before we start the session, there are a few points that we have to keep in mind. A. Please keep your microphone off for the entire duration of the webinar so as to not disrupt the proceedings. You may turn your video on or off as per your convenience. There will be two different parts for the session, the speaker session on the topic, and then we'll be having the question and answer session at the end. For the question and answer session, which will be at the end of the webinar, if you have a question, please raise your hands on Zoom. The moderator will then pick 5 participants at random from those who have raised their hands for the speaker to answer. You'll be allowed to unmute your microphone by the moderator only during this time to facilitate better discussion. Introduce yourself and then ask a question to the speaker. I'll now hand over the stage to Meenakshi for the introduction. We will now officially start the session, and sorry for the late timing that have happened due to the glitch that have taken place. Thank you. Meenakshi, you have the floor now.
Thank you, Kevin. Good evening, everyone, and a very warm welcome to the third session of the Secret of the Circle webinar series, an event organized by Nauticum's Event Management Private Limited. We are a student-led initiative that aims at promoting awareness about world issues in the youth. Our flagship event is the Global Youth Colloquium Model United Nations, also known as the GYCMUN. This webinar series aims at keeping the youth empowered with the happenings of the world and encourages them to share their thoughts about the same. We've decided to name the webinar series The Secret of the Circle to portray the discussions here occur without a power hierarchy, symbolizing a circle which represents unity, harmony, and equal consideration of all its participants. Today's webinar is on the topic Bureaucracy and Democracy, the Voice of Dissent in Governance. Democracy is often considered to be one of the most accepted or favored form of governance, primarily due to the fact that the citizens do, to an extent, have a certain privilege or, so to say, a right to dissent, as long as it's in consonance with the constitutional rights guaranteed to others. Whereas such dissent is often faced with severe punishments in a more authoritarian or dictatorial setup. Today, living in a democratic setup, we often see the opposite happening. Today, we have with us Mr. Kannan Gopinath, former IAS officer and a social activist hailing from Kerala. He resigned from the services as a mark of the protest against the restrictions imposed in Jammu and Kashmir following the abrogation of Article 370. Post his resignation, he has been vocal with regard to the same. Similarly, he has also been active in the anti-CAA protest. Sir, I welcome you and we look forward to your talk. We request you to now take the floor.
Hi, first of all, thank you for having me in the session. I was attending another session, and then in between you have like 1 hour time here, and then we will go. I have to attend the same meeting again. So what we'll do is that I'll try to keep my part of the session a little short so that we can do a more of an interaction. Is that fine? Yeah. Okay.
Yes, sir.
So the topic that is assigned to me is bureaucracy and bureaucracy in democracy, or the dissent in governance. To be honest, whether you made an assessment in the sense that democracy is considered to be a more acceptable form of governance, right? But whether it is the most natural form of governance, we don't know. It could be an acceptable form of governance because we have tend to agreed on certain aspects that an individual is of utmost importance. That is where our concept of democracy becomes primary, because we are saying it's not a larger goal. It's not a kingdom, it's not a king, it's not a nation that is more important, but it is the individual that is important. And it is those individuals' desires, it is those individuals' actions, so that should guide the country as a whole. You know, so the primacy of a citizen was a key concept when it came to democracy. But it was not very easy. It is not very easy to be a citizen in a democracy, because to be a citizen in a democracy means you need to understand issues, you need to analyze those issues, you need to question those issues. Even at times, you need to get out and protest on those issues. So to be a citizen in a democracy is really difficult. So I've often said this, democracy is a very difficult project. It's not a very natural, very easy kind of a thing. And the biggest threat to a democracy doesn't come from a dictator. The biggest threat to a democracy comes from a lazy citizenry, wherein the citizens decide that, okay, now it's anyway a very difficult project. So what we'll do is that we will place our entire faith, we'll place our entire trust in a certain individual or an organization or party or whichever way we is, that we are not going to exercise our own discretion, we are not going to analyze issues by ourselves, rather we are going to go ahead by whatever a particular individual is saying or a party is saying. So we have taken a backseat as an individual and saying that this is exactly what my line is going to be. If the party takes this line or my leader takes this line, then that is going to be my line and that is it. And this kind of a citizenry wherein individuals or citizens are not playing the role that they are supposed to is the most dangerous thing to a democracy. That is what I believe. Because that enables a dictatorship, that enables an authoritarianism. No authoritarian leader, no dictator can come and take the stage unless the people are willing, either willing or people are too complacent or people are too lazy to react to it. It is only in these two scenarios where a person can actually take over the country. And at the same time, authoritarianism is a very easy project because it asks only one thing from a person. It just says, be loyal to me. Okay, you don't have to understand as such, life is difficult for a person, especially developing or a country like ours. It is, for a citizen, there are a lot of his day-to-day issues that he needs to fight, right? And his fight is not about 90% of his time. His fight, when it comes to government, is also not with the prime minister or his policies or his dictatorial attitude or how the government, parliament is not being made to function. No, that is not his concern. His concern 90% of the time is your constable or an SHO or a CI or a circle inspector, taking you to the police station for you won't know what, for what reason. You are given a couple of lathi, beatings and then sent back home. Or maybe you have a very legitimate case for a benefit, a government benefit that should come to you. You are unable to receive it, or it's something related to your land. You go to the government office to register your land. You are treated very shabbily there and then asked to go back. So his day-to-day fights are more of an existential level. It is not a fight for a freedom of expression, a constitutional values, fundamental rights, that he doesn't realize it. The fight is essentially the same. The fight for a freedom of expression, the fight for asserting the citizenry, the values of citizenry is exactly the same whether you are speaking against the prime minister or you are speaking against the collector or the SP or an SHO or the circle inspector or whoever. It's essentially the same because you are speaking to power. The power could be in very different forms at very different levels. So this aspect of it, when people understand how come these simplistic solutions come, because as such life is difficult, we don't want to burden you with having discussions on policy issues and XYZ. Rather, you believe us, you trust me. Once you place your trust in me, you don't have to bother about individual issues. All that you have to do is to support me, and once you support me, I'll deliver, right? Because it becomes so easy for us. If somebody in your family says, forget about all, I'll tell you which course you have to take after 12th. I have already made all the decision for you. After 12th, I'll tell. The freedom of choice is also a burden. I think it was probably during Nazi Germany time, there was this concept which came, the burden of freedom. It actually places a lot of burden on individuals. So if somebody is there to make a choice for you all the time, and if you trust him, it becomes an easy thing. And many of the families, this is how it happens, until and or at the time when it completely breaks and you realize like you have been taken for a ride and the family is no more in a position to survive any longer. But it, most of the time, the realization comes a little late than you know, what should be. And this is where lazy citizenry becomes the most dangerous enabler for a democracy, or you know, for democracy to fall into an authoritarianism. And that was one of the key aspects for why I resigned from my own post. It was not just that the government went ahead and did 370 abrogation. That is a separate thing. That it's a constitutional position. If government wants to do it, doesn't want it, that is, you know, that is also a concern whether how they are going to do it, whether they're going to do it through constitutionally acceptable means or not. But more important than that was how they said that nobody has a right to react to anything that this government is doing. Entire state, if it comes to that, we will shut down an entire state. And they were pretty sure that the nation will not, you know, speak up against it. The nation will not come out and say, no, this is not acceptable. You cannot simply shut down an entire state. And they were very sure of this fact, that people will be standing behind the government rather than with the people in Kashmir. And that belief, they are actually proven right. We were silent. Either we were silent or we were supporting. Even if we had concerns, we were thinking, okay, but government must be having some plan. And for that plan, these temporary things are required. So, okay, let's support it. But that is where the concept of an individual or a citizen, the importance of a citizen in a democracy comes into picture. You know, that, and it is not also the case that we will be lying to ourselves if we are saying all this happened only during this government, or you know, particularly this particular 370. I'm talking from my own part. We were on a journey. When the British were there, we were protected people. You know, we were called as a protected people. Before that, when the kings were there, we were subjects. The king was the king and we were subjects. And then we were protected people, we were also sort of like subjects because we didn't have any right. But there were certain systems put in place and we would be allowed to function within those systems. So there are some systemic things to it. And then we became a citizen. The essential part of being a citizen is that you have inalienable rights. Is become from a subject to a citizen when you have assertive rights. You know, you can assert your rights. You can say that X, Y, Z is my rights. Okay, we are ready to pull in certain part of it and come to a contract for building a nation. But that inalienable rights of the individual was the underlying principle for being a citizen. And we didn't. We 100% of us were not citizens at the to begin with. We were on a very slow journey. A very painful journey from maybe a subject or a protected people to being citizens. 10-20% had this freedom of expression, freedom of movement, freedom of assembly to maybe question the government, to question those who are in power, whereas 80% of the people in our country did not have those powers, freedom of life. So you would see a farmer, if he needs to talk to a government official, he'll need somebody. He will need somebody's reference to go to a government office. He can't just go walk in directly. A tribal, I was in Dadra Nagar Haveli. Initially, they never used to come directly. They would make somebody through some third person will come and then will come and meet you. It took some time for that to change. Why? It is their own country. The office established to serve them, with tax being raised from them, including my salary, including everybody's, every single thing of that thing was being run from them. But even after that, for them to come here, mostly it will be with folded hands. Even if it is a rightful thing, it will not be an assertive citizen. It will be a pleading citizen. You shouldn't even call a citizen. It's like a pleading subject. And these kings are not only at the top level of a government of India level or a government of a state level. That king concept comes at every level of power, every level of authority. That we are here, we are in a position of power. You are our subjects. You come here, plead before us, and we'll take a decision whether it is for you, whether we want to do something good for you or not. And this kind of, it is so much ingrained. So our path from being a subject to a citizen, this most important path that as a nation we are undertaking, from being a subject, making our individuals, our citizens, this country, from being a subject to a citizen. it was very slow. Because even today, if you get out, if you're, you know, right now, 11 o'clock or something, you'll get out, walk, or, you know, on a side of the road, and if a police vehicle comes, or a beat constable is coming in a bike, he will, you know, just give you two beatings with his lathi. And you will say, sir, you know, why are you beating me? You will not say, how dare you beat me? You will not say, who are you to beat me? You will instead be asking, why are you beating me? Then he'll say, go back home. Okay, sir, we are going back home. That will be the end of it. You will not be opposing it. You will not be saying, in my own country, for not doing anything wrong, how come you are using the power of the state? Because, you know, state has the monopoly on violence, legitimate violence. So how are you using that monopoly to just be, and nobody is there. We have not become what you call as a citizen. If you are a citizen, we would be asking the other question, how dare you do it? No, this is not, you are there to serve us, not to beat us. That kind of a questioning we are yet to come to, and that's a long journey. What happened during this period, what happened during of late, was that people in power, especially realizing that since it is only 10 to 20% of the people who had this power, of asking questions to people who are in authority, or you know, the freedom of expression per se, 80% of the people there didn't have it. So anyway, it doesn't matter even if we stop this altogether. There is no point in giving it to those 10-20 also. Instead, focus on delivery. Delivery of gas cylinder, delivery of toilet, delivery of, you know, maybe 2,000 rupees per month for 3 months for a farmer. So focus on delivery. And the 10-20% of the people who had freedom of expression, they would be thinking our freedom of expression has been taken away. But for the 80%, nothing has been taken away because they didn't have, you know, to begin with. But instead, they have got a better scheme delivery. What in effect happening, that journey as a nation that we are supposed to take gets halted. And then we start the other way around, making everybody again into a subject. You can't question. You can't, you know, there are a couple of FIRs against me after my resignation. One of the FIR was for criticizing the Prime Minister. I said, I am ashamed of you, Mr. Modi. And on for that, there is an FIR filed in Rajkot. Just for writing that, you know, how do I, I'm unable to, reconcile the absurd nature of that affair. But that is possible. That is possible because we have altered that journey. Instead of expanding those rights to more and more citizens, we have decided it is no more important to do it. Rather, take it away from the rest of the people also, and then focus on deliveries. Make them beneficiaries. Beneficiaries of the government. It's like you have an uncle who comes and gives you 1,000 rupees every month. You will not question him, you know, because he is giving you pocket money. And if every one of us is made into a beneficiary like that, because market-linked subsidies are all being taken away, and targeted beneficiaries, this direct benefit transfer-oriented subsidies are being given. So when you do that, you are effectively making a citizen into a beneficiary. Every citizen, and this is a very organized database. It improves on efficiency, it reduces corruption, but it is disempowering. So the positives are there, the negative is also there. What is of more importance to us is something that we as a country we need to decide. So that is on little bit on the democracy part, on the bureaucracy and democracy. Yes, I have been there for around 7 years in service, and Delhi, and then in Mizoram, and then in Dadra Nagar Haveli. In fact, Dadra Nagar Haveli was a little more challenging in that aspect because there was tremendous amount of pressure from the top on various issues. But as a bureaucrat, you can definitely, when it comes to you, when it comes to your own decision, you can of course take a call as to, okay, I will not do it, I will not do this, I will not do that. Your consequences may be maximum, it will be transferred, there will be some show-cause notice issued to you, that's all. Nothing more can happen because you have a protection of Article 311 in the Constitution, which prevents you from being dismissed or beyond a point, no penal action is possible. So that protective cover is there, the protection is there for a bureaucrat of an Article 311. It's like having a bulletproof vest. You can have a bulletproof vest, but to face bullet, you need courage. Just having a bulletproof vest doesn't mean you will get up and, ready, I'm ready to fight. No, for that you need courage. So there is a protection, but at the same time, a lot of us are being put into different categories of if you don't do this, then we will find something against you and then we'll try to capture you there. Or, okay, you have a right to express your views, do, go ahead and do it, but we will catch you somewhere else and then we will show you a place there. So it becomes a very, you know, it makes an individual, especially people who are in bureaucracy, they are given a tough choice. You want to express or you want to have a normal life? What is it that you want? Or if you are even more aligned with us, then of course you will get much bigger, better posting, you will get bigger, whatever kind of incentives are there in the government, you will get all that. But if you are saying on the other way, you are going to exercise your freedom of expression rights, then it's not necessarily through a conduct rules, because conduct rule explicitly says, our view, especially the IAS, all these abuses, conduct rule says you can't speak against the policies, to openly criticize the policies of the government. It has not yet been challenged in a constitutional court whether that such kind of a rule is possible, because especially when it is challenged against an Article 19, whether it is tenable or not. But even beyond that, because you are working in a setup, you are working in a system wherein there are superiors to you. So if, let's say, I say something against the government and government tries to give me a show cause notice on that, I reply to it, okay, the matter ends there. But the grudge is there. And that grudge would make sure that on a continuous basis, you are targeted for X, Y, Z or something else. And this becomes a continuous process. So this is where, not through a direct thing, but it's like any other employer. You are in a company working and you started speaking against the company. The company cannot maybe directly remove you, but it will make sure that you will leave yourself. So the kind of environment in the bureaucracy is also same. Whether it is correct or not, when Sardar Patel especially had argued for continuing with the civil services, especially in the form of Indian Administrative Service and Indian Police Service, his point was that we need a bureaucracy, we need an executive, permanent executive, which is unafraid, to speak the truth to power, and they should be provided with that protection so that they are unafraid to speak truth to the power. Protection is only one part of it. Ultimately, we are individuals, and individuals are driven not by, the bare minimum protection that they get. Okay, you cannot be kicked out of the service, but you also have desires, you also have aims, you also have career goals, you have also have families. So there are various other aspects of it which comes into picture. So you take a decision as to, it's better to keep silent. What's the big deal? And in that way, he also behaves just like every other citizen. His decisions are not decided by his conscience, but his decisions are decided by the consequences. So you do an analysis and say, okay, better to keep quiet. And it becomes a habit. You just go along with that. And we, after a certain period, I use this analogy, the bureaucracy at times is like a chef or in a restaurant or a so the bureaucracy knows to cook so many dishes. There are so many kinds, varieties of things that you can make, but they also know that the customer or the staff, the boss, he likes only one kind of dish. So they don't then explore the other things. You know that Saab ko yehi pasand hai, that he only likes this, so just serve him that only. And after 2 years, 3 years, in fact, some of you might get into service sometime or the other, he will realize that even a peon will know that whether this file is going to get cleared or not, because it will be very clear. It will be very clear that, okay, Saab ko yehi pasand hai, Saab ko yehi nahi pasand. And so, which is not, Saab ko jo pasand nahi hai, uspe mehnat karne ka koi matlab hi nahi hai. There is no point even putting effort in that. Rather, just go ahead and put a file which might get approved. Why waste energy in that aspect? So for dissent to work in bureaucracy, dissent needs to work in democracy, because bureaucracy is a very micro part or a very small subsystem. It's not a system, it's a very subsystem of a larger system, larger political system, larger democratic system. And unless the dissent, the voice comes from outside of it, Whereas a lot of people see it the other way. They see that people who are in positions of power, why they are not taking a principled stand? Because why should they? They are precisely in positions of power. Why would they want to lose it? They wouldn't want to lose that position of power. They wouldn't want to lose the comfort. So it is foolish to expect to expect people in positions of power to act on consensus. Rather, it is people who are affected by those decisions, who are outside of those positions of power, who should be acting as a pressure point, who should be acting as a counter pressure to these people in power, so that the balance is maintained. When the voice comes continuously, in a democracy, we used to say there is a lot of noise, there is a lot of, nothing gets done because, it's just a noisy democracy. That noise is very important. That noise is very important because we are such a vast, diverse kind of a country. And unless those voices don't get heard of the last individual, I don't think democracy would serve that purpose. So this is an aspect, maybe we can further get into discussion into. We have like half an hour for discussion, so I've kept my part of the speech short. If the, it's open for discussion now, Alex, however you want to go about it.
Yes, thank you, sir. Thank you so much, sir, for taking your time from your busy schedule to talk to us on bureaucracy and democracy, voice of dissent in governance. It was definitely an informative session. I'm sure that we all learned something and unlearned at least some misconceptions about the democratic structures within the democratic pillar of non-legislative executive and about how far we truly are a democracy. With this end of this talk, I'm sure there are a lot of intriguing questions that are there in everyone's mind. So without any further delay, we shall now go ahead onto the question answer session. If you have a question, please raise your hand on Zoom Cloud Meeting. Please raise your hand and a participant will be chosen by the moderator at random form, where from whoever has raised their hands to ask a question to the speaker. You will be allowed to unmute your microphone by the moderator only during this time to facilitate better discussion. Introduce yourself first before asking your question. Now, just to give a heads up about how to go ahead for the benefit of all about the procedure to do the same, follow the following steps to raise your hand in Zoom Cloud Meetings. Firstly, during a meeting, click on the icon labeled Participants at the bottom center of your PC or Mac screen. At the bottom of the window, on the right-hand side of the screen, click the button labeled Raise Hand. Your digital hand is now raised. Then thirdly, lower it by clicking the same button. Now it is labeled Lower Hand. Or else, if you're using a device, simply tap on Raise Hand at the bottom left corner of the screen. The hand icon will turn blue and then the text below it will switch to say Lower Hand while your hand is raised. Those who wish to ask questions, please raise your hand now. Thank you. All right. Sir, can we start with the Q&A then? First person to raise is Mohan Krishna. Please switch on your audio and ask a question.
Good evening, sir. This is Mohan. So my question is, actually, sir, there is a lot of pressure from the from officials. So how can the bureaucrats overcome that? Like, there are many possibilities that you have taken a great step by resigning. Are there any other steps we can also do, like controlling the pressure?
So I think I'd like to come here and say that I didn't resign because of what was locally. Of course, there is pressure. It is not the case that there is no pressure one way or the other. But once you are in the service, you learn that pressures are actually temporary. It is not a lifelong kind of a thing. It will go in a between, and it will come. So my resignation was not because of pressure faced by individual in my own capacity. In fact, I had taken a lot of battles myself in where I was posted. And you can actually weather that. It is not possible, provided ready to take you might be having a very premium position or a coveted position, as it is called. And once you take such a decision, then they might you might not agree with what they say, and they might transfer you from there. Fine, they can only transfer you. Like it won't affect your salary. It won't affect. Okay, you might be moved away from a bungalow that has so many of these facilities to a smaller quarters. But most of your emoluments, most of your own facts of life will remain the same. So it is not that difficult if the decision is coming through you. Like in my own case, I can tell before the 2019 election, there were like in Kashmir, there is something called a PSA in Kashmir. So we had something called PASA. PASA is actually the collector can send people to jail for 6 months. And before the elections, I'm getting a couple of messages. before the election, what happened was, there was a meeting, and then we were told, both the SP and myself, we were told that we should send two people from a particular community, of course, the Muslim community, to be processed under PASA, and we should be sent to jail. The file came to me because normally police is a very hierarchical structure, so the orders come and they'll immediately follow it up. It came to me, and I said, no, there is no case being made here. So as a collector, you have to exercise your discretion, and then you said that, okay, there are a lot of pressure, there are many meetings, your own seniors, your own people who are higher up, they're all taking meetings and pushing. Funny incident, because I said not fair to put target a community just before the general elections. So then the direction was that then put a Hindu name also. The point was not Hindu or Muslim. The point was to ensure that there is PASA, and then people should have fear, that people should be afraid of of the government, of the system, of people who are in authority. Generally, people should be kept in a position, in a fearful kind of a situation. You rejected, they got angry. There were a couple of other instances also during election which happened. There was a lot of interference. As a district election officer, I had to write to the election commission against the concerned political person. It came about in a way that after the election commission gave some direction to that particular political individual. After the elections, after a couple of months, of course, you are transferred from the post, you are given some additional different charges, you will move away from your collector bungalow, you will move to some other place, but you knew it. So it is not that when you take these decisions, you don't know that certain things will happen, but you know what are the things that are going to happen. Your salary is not going to get reduced, right? Even 99% of the time, you will still retain your vehicle, your house may be slightly different. So these are the only things. So I don't know as to why it is that it is so difficult to say no to what the things that you disagree with. But if think the other way, now if you would have obeyed, maybe you could have been posted in a prime minister's office as an undersecretary or a deputy secretary, or you could have been given some more charges, or you could have been told that you can have little more of a. So if you're driven by what, if you're driven by that kind of a career goal, then your decision will also be decided by that. It will not be decided by what you think is right or wrong. It will be decided by what benefits you or what will cause you harm. So it is an individual decision. And the Constitution provides enough protection. The case in point is also, an officer in Haryana who has been transferred every 6 months, and he has been very vocal against the, almost all governments. But he completed his tenure and he retired. Till that period, nothing could be done beyond being transferred, beyond being transferred. So this is the this feeling that if there is pressure from above or from people who are sitting above you to make you do something, you have to necessarily obey it. I don't think so. I don't agree to that. Maximum it can have, especially when you are in positions of power, great power, great power like IPS or an IAS. You have a lot of leverage and you can survive easily without taking much of a hit, provided you are content that what you have done is as per your own constraints and you are ready to take the consequences also.
Thank you, sir. Next question from Joseph Gilson. Mr. Joseph Gilson, please ask question.
Okay, good evening, sir. The thing I wanted to ask was, as students, what steps can we possibly take to bring about any changes, if any?
Yeah, no, actually, the only people who have made any change anywhere in the world is actually students. Nobody else. Why? Because students think in a little more clearer ways. My own interaction with, I've been to some 20 universities during degree. My own interaction has conveyed to me that if the things are clear, like, okay, this is right, this is wrong. Certain things are wrong, and that should be at least said as wrong. Maybe you're not in a position to do anything about it, but at least to be said as wrong. Because students have a future. They don't have anything to lose, but they have a future, they have a country, they have a country of their own design to gain from. So you are in the process of making your own country, that, you know, the way you want it. Whereas a lot of middle-aged people, by this time, they have accumulated certain aspects, be it an EMI on a loan, or EMI of a house or a car, or your student being studying somewhere else, or your business having some certain issues, or your own house having. Everybody is a potential criminal in India, because our laws are such that, like that. If you have a house, I'm pretty sure that will be violating one of the municipal bylaws in that area. If you're, slightly your balcony is extending, or you've made something protruding out of your building, that is essentially a violation of a building bylaw. So every single thing from your electricity, from your fire safety, from your disaster aspect, from your municipal bylaws, every single thing, you have violated some law or the other. And you start realizing this, you understand that the best way to survive is to keep silent. Right, wrong is all secondary. Is that what is more important? You have gained something during this period, you need to hold on to it. And the best way to hold on to it is by being silent. So that is where actually students have shown, everywhere, across the world, the students have shown that if at all change has to come, it will come from them. What you can do is first to start with understanding issues, and understanding that disagreements shouldn't become yourself into enemies. Your own disagreements with other students, other people, shouldn't end up making them into your enemies. It shouldn't become hatred. It shouldn't become like to an extent where you don't care what happens. So this is something which you have seen, especially on social media nowadays, that if you disagree, then you are a traitor, you are, or a dictator, or a fascist, or it's all in the extremes. It's all in the complete extreme. It is disagreement. We need to realize, as people of this country, at least, who are joining from India, we share have a common future. We share a common future. No matter what your disagreements are, you might disagree with me on 100 things, but 99% of the probability is that we both have a common future, because we both belong to the same country. If the country does well, we do well. If the country goes down, we all go down. The disagreements, how to express, not be silent, express, but don't hate. Both are important. Being silent is equally bigger crime as being hateful. So we need to learn how to express without being hateful, without making into enemies. And if you are able to do that, as at least the next generation, the previous generation, I don't know, maybe I'm mistaken, but I think was a very mute generation, especially the post-liberalization, that 1990 the people who became at that point of time. It was because we were also coming from an insecure period, to just secure your own livelihood kind of a period during that phase. So we all went into just let it be. Mind your own business, study well, do something, earn money, settle down. So this became the motto for people across the country for an entire generation. And it is that new generation which took their feet away from that pedal, and saying that, you know, let it be on autopilot. That's what has resulted in a lot of authoritarian tendencies that we see in the country. So it is important to get back, you know, regain your voice and speak up without being spiteful. Express without being, you know, even if people disagree, it's fine. Without name calling, without character assassination, without saying, irrespective of what the other person is saying about you. No, without all that, if you are able to engage and actively, this country got independence through non-violent movement. You know, people came out, and I think Mahatma Gandhi's biggest call was not to anybody else. The biggest call was to students. And he gave a call which was so explicit. He said, even if your parents don't allow you, doesn't matter, be like a Prahlad, you know, who had to disobey his own parents. That such an explicit call was what Mahatma Gandhi had given during that period. And it was, again, thanks to students during the emergency time, 1975 to 75, it began as a student movement again. And it was always the students who led the movement for democracy across the country, not just in India, everywhere. This movement for freedom, this movement for freedom of expression has always been led by students. So be part of it. Don't keep yourself silent. Express, organize. Organize in the sense, I'm not saying that you become some sort of a... But be connected. Be connected to each other. And as and when it requires, do not be afraid to question power. Do not be afraid to take to the streets if required. So do not be afraid to be a citizen. Whatever is that the Constitution provides to you, it is for you to exercise. If you don't exercise those rights, then it will be like, you know, wasting. You might have a hand, and if you don't use it for a long time, you are wasting. You know, that wasting happens, and you later you won't know how to use that hand. So exercise your rights to the fullest so that it doesn't get eroded. That is the only way we can bring a change, or at least hold on to what we have today.
Thank you, sir.
I'm sorry, Alex. I see somebody I know here, Mr. Brijesh. So he is from, he's a very vibrant activist, tribal activist from Dadra Nagar Haveli, my previous place of posting. He has been raising his hands, I think. Will it be okay if you can say...
Yes, it's business from Brijesh Basaravati, so we were about to ask him.
Okay.
So, next question from you, sir.
Hello.
Hello,
sir. Sir, my question is that कि हम लोग पंचायत राज को कैसे बचा सकते हैं और आपको बहुत मिस कर रहे
हैं बस हो गया क्वेश्चन
ना सर ये पंचायत राज को कैसे बचाना है सर
ठीक है थैंक यू नहीं मैं भी मिस कर रहा हूँ दादरा नगर हवेली में स्पेशली सब लोगों के साथ मिलके काम करने का मौका था तो काफी सारे मैसेजेस आते हैं अभी भी वहाँ से कई सारे लोग बल्कि रूलिंग पार्टी के भी कई सारे लोग मैसेज करते हैं कि सर बहुत हो गया बहुत परेशानी हो रहे हैं यहाँ पे अभी जीना मुश्किल हो रहा है करके और हाँ बात इतना मतलब क्यों अभी ब्रजेश क्यों ऐसा कह रहा है कि मिस कर रहा है इसलिए नहीं था कि मैंने कुछ वहां पे किया पर सुनना भी बहुत बड़ी बात होती थी मतलब कि हाँ तो आके आपको बता सकते हैं कि अपनी प्रॉब्लम वो भी बहुत धीरे धीरे करके वो सारे राइट्स जा रहा है एंड सो दिस इज नॉट अ थियोरेटिकल थिंग वो एकदम जो जमीनी स्तर पर हो रहा है आज उसी के बारे में बात कर रहा है आज उसका कॉन्टेक्स्ट भी पता है वहाँ पे ही नहीं पूरी देश में हो रहा है और इसको समझने की जरूरत है एक प्रिंसिपल था हम जब हम थियोरेटिकली बात करते हैं तो हमें लगता है कि ये तो हवा में बात हो रही है हमारे बारे में बात नहीं हो रहा जैसे जो जिस बंदे को लगता है कि पुलिस कॉन्स्टेबल मेरे को मार क्यों रहा है उसको मैं बोलूं कि ये फ्रीडम ऑफ एक्सप्रेशन का वायलेशन है तो उसको समझ में नहीं आएगा उसको लगेगा फ्रीडम ऑफ एक्सप्रेशन क्या फालतू की जिसे बोल रहे हैं यहाँ पे पिटाई हो रहा है मेरा और ये फ्रीडम ऑफ एक्सप्रेशन और फंडामेंटल राइट्स की बात कर रहे हैं बात एक ही है फ्रीडम ऑफ एक्सप्रेशन फंडामेंटल राइट्स उसका भी उसको एक कॉन्स्टेबल से आर्ग्यू करने का या कलेक्टर के पास जाके झगड़ा करने का फ्रीडम ऑफ एक्सप्रेशन भी वही है जो मेरा फ्रीडम ऑफ एक्सप्रेशन है मेरा प्रधानमंत्री से लड़ने का एक ही है जो पावर से असर्टिवली अपनी बात रखने का जो पावर है ना वो जब मेरा फ्रीडम ऑफ एक्सप्रेशन प्रधानमंत्री के साथ नहीं होता है
तो आपका भी नहीं होगा जो कलेक्टर के साथ है या फिर अपना तहसीलदार के साथ, ये बराबरी का होता है। ये बातें हमें समझना जरूरी है, सबसे पहली बात ये लिंक्ड है दो अलग अलग चीज में। ये इसी कॉन्टेक्स्ट में बताऊंगा, जैसे प्रिंसिपल ऑफ सब्सिडियरिटी करके एक कंसेप्ट था, तो पंचायत राज आया उस कंसेप्ट के थ्रू। प्रिंसिपल ऑफ सब्सिडियरिटी ये कहता है कि जो चीजें जितने लोकल लेवल पे हो सकता है उतना लोकल लेवल होना चाहिए, तो जो चीज अगर गांव के अंदर हो सकते हैं वो गांव के अंदर ही, उसका पावर फंड फंक्शन फंक्शनरी सब कुछ उसी गांव के अंदर होना चाहिए, उससे थोड़ा बढ़ के हो सकता है जो पॉसिबल है। तो टैक्सेशन पावर्स भी हमारा ये प्लान था कि टैक्सेशन पावर्स भी कितने कितने तरीके से लोकलाइज किया जाए, जैसे एक स्वच्छ भारत का सेस है तो वो सारे जगह से कलेक्ट करके सेंट्रल गवर्नमेंट के पास जाए, फिर सेंट्रल गवर्नमेंट डिसाइड करेगा कि नहीं कहाँ पे स्वच्छ होना चाहिए, उसके जगह पे अगर वहीं के वहीं गांव के लोग जो है वो स्वच्छ भारत से कलेक्ट करें और वहीं गांव वाले उसको इस्तेमाल करें कि अपने गांव को साफ करने में, तो ये इसका कंसेप्ट का डिफरेंस था। प्रिंसिपल ऑफ सब्सिडियरिटी का सबसे पहला झटका जो लगा था वो जीएसटी था, तब हमें उसको बात को समझ नहीं पाए, क्योंकि जीएसटी ऐसे लगा जब हम बात कर रहे थे हम कि पंचायत को टैक्सेशन पावर देने की, और जीएसटी में हमने पूरी स्टेट का ही टैक्सेशन पावर ले लिया। हमने बोला कि पंचायत को तो छोड़ो, जब स्टेट के पास ही टैक्स करके अपने मतलब पावर्स की फेडरल सिस्टम में जो डिसेंट्रलाइज सिस्टम है वो ही नहीं रहे, अभी तो आज उसका ही हम देख रहे हैं क्योंकि स्टेट गवर्नमेंट भी मांग रहे सेंट्रल गवर्नमेंट के पास, जबकि हमारे सिस्टम बहुत ज्यादा फेडरल हुआ करता था, तो फेडरलाइजेशन और डिसेंट्रलाइजेशन की जो मूवमेंट है वहां से खत्म होके हम वापस यूनियन सेंट्रलाइजेशन पे जा रहा है, तो उसी का इम्पैक्ट है जो पंचायत राज में भी हो रहा है। तो जब ये लगता नहीं है कि गलत है, जब ये प्रोसेस ही लगता नहीं है गलत है, तो एक एक इंडिविजुअल इंस्टेंसेस को लड़ना मुश्किल है। इंडिविजुअल इंस्टेंसेस को लड़ने के लिए समझना होगा कि पूरी की पूरी प्रोसेस गलत है, ये पूरी की प्रोसेस गलत है, इसलिए हमें उल्टा जाने की जरूरत है। ज्यादा से ज्यादा पावर जो है पंचायत के पास होना चाहिए, कम पावर जो है इनफैक्ट बल्कि एक जिला में भी जिला पंचायत के पास होना चाहिए बहुत सारे पावर्स, मतलब उसके बाद जो बचता है वो स्टेट गवर्नमेंट के पास आना चाहिए, और जितना मिनिमम हो सकता है वो यूनिसेंट्रल गवर्नमेंट के पास आना चाहिए, ताकि डिसाइड कर सकता है जो लोकल प्रायोरिटीज है। मैं अपनी एग्जाम्पल से बात कर रहा हूँ, मिजोरम में था, नाथियल में पोस्टेड था, म्यांमार बॉर्डर में एक सब डिविजन है वो, और डिजिटल इंडिया और जनधन योजना चल रहा था और वहाँ पूरा सब डिविजन में इंटरनेट नहीं होता नहीं था, 2015 की बात कर रहा हूँ, इंटरनेट था ही नहीं, और कहाँ से डिजिटल इंडिया लागू करेंगे। जनधन योजना की बात कर रहे हैं कि पूरा सबडिविजन में एक एटीएम तक नहीं है, पूरा सबडिविजन में कहाँ से लोग मतलब बैंक अकाउंट में पैसा रखेंगे, क्योंकि नहीं रख सकते ना, जब आपको निकालने का सुविधा नहीं है पैसा एटीएम से तो आप रखेंगे भी नहीं। तो ये जो कंसेप्ट है ये थियरी और प्रैक्टिस जो है ये लिंक्ड है, इसको हम एक को डिस्कार्ड करके दूसरे को हम बचा नहीं सकते, कि दोनों को द प्रोसेसेस जो कंसेप्ट है प्रिंसिपल ऑफ सिक्योरिटी सही, द कंसेप्ट ऑफ बीइंग अ सिटीजन जो कैसे एक सिटीजन बन सकता है वो सही, ये सारे ही इंटरलिंक्ड है बोथ द प्रैक्टिसेस एंड द थ्योरीज एंड द प्रोसेसेस। तो दिस इज व्हाई द कलेक्टिव असर्शन एज एन इंडिविजुअल बट कलेक्टिवली असर्टेड, यू नो, अगर हम सब मिलके हमारी जो इंडिविजुअल असर्शन करेंगे देन वी विल डेफिनेटली get it back on track, हमें वापस अब पटरी पे लाना है ताकि प्रोसेस शुरू वापस हो सकते हैं जिसमें अल्टीमेटली पावर्स जिनको एक्चुअली हेल्प कर सकता है उनके पास उतना करीब जा सकता है, जितना जितना ज्यादा करीब जनता के पास पावर जा सकता है उतना ज्यादा वो जा पाए। सो आई थिंक दैट इज नो वी हैव सेवन मोर मिनट्स सॉरी सर,
वी हैव अ फाइनल
आपका स्पेसिफिक क्वेश्चन है ब्रजेश, उसके लिए अलग से बात करेंगे, है ना?
ठीक
So, we have one more final question. So, the last question is from Mr. Satyam Sundaram. Mr. Satyam Sundaram, please ask your question.
Hello, sir. I am Satyam Sundaram from Delhi University. Sir, we have encountered some incidents of custodial theft recently in Tamil Nadu and last year in Kerala. And this year, we have seen a custodial theft in America which gathered a mass protest. But why such cases don't gather such gravity of protest in India? And what is the responsibility of bureaucrats in such cases?
Very, very interesting and in fact very serious issue. Because before especially the custodial theft that happened in Tamil Nadu, a couple of us were working on police reforms. Police reforms not from a police perspective,
as to policing should be more independent from politics, etc. Rather, police reforms from a democratic perspective, wherein how policing should be made more and more accountable through democratic means. Why a lot of it happens is because, as we initially also said, for a person can be beaten up for just standing, and anywhere it can be done, and across the country it is done very normally. When you remember when this migrant crisis happened, migrant labor got stuck in various cities, and they wanted to go back, and there was no way for them to go back. They didn't ask any question to the government. They didn't protest. They were not given food. They were not given water, many of them. They were living in very congested spaces, shared toilet facilities, shared kitchen spaces. The best way to get a COVID infection, rather, and especially in those cities where there were hotspots. And they were forced to stay there against their own will. They wanted to go back. And when they were desperate, they didn't protest. What did they do? They took their babies or children or baggage and etc. and they walked. I myself remember seeing from here people walking to Allahabad from Mumbai. 1200 kilometers they're walking. And they're saying, "Kahan ja rahe ho? We are going to Allahabad." And walking. 2020 in India, lakhs of people walk back to their home, and when they crossed one state border to the other state border, we beat them up. Our own policemen, we beat our own citizens. For we didn't give them food, we didn't give them water, we didn't give them train, we didn't give them bus. They are walking back to their homes, and we are beating them on top of that. That is where the concept of a citizen, because we are not citizens. We are subjects. We don't have rights. We can't go back. We can be beaten up anywhere. And we are used to it. And that is the concept that, you know, unless we change that part of it, unless we change the power equations in every transaction, every interaction, not just the larger questions of freedom of expression in state oppression, but at every interaction, an interaction that happens at a village office, an interaction that happens at a police station, unless that changes, it's very difficult, you know, for us to get back onto that path. And I was not surprised that we didn't see a mass protest, because we are used to anything. We are used to getting beaten up, we are used to getting killed. We are okay. It becomes a story to share. It becomes so bad. You know, it shouldn't have happened. So that is all. We don't even have a legislative oversight. You know, I was proposing something like, can we have a legislative oversight committees in all those legislative assemblies, wherein the concerned MLAs can at least call the state police, the DGP or the SP, and ask them questions. We are running away from democracy. We are saying, no, officers should be independent. Officers should be made independent of the democracy. No, we have already seen that. That is dangerous. Because tomorrow some powerful person can come, and this entire bureaucracy would line with that person, with absolutely no concern for democratic values. So the path forward is to be more democratization, more local accountability, how to enforce it, whether we are able to have it at a police station level, a citizen-led committee, a citizen in the sense it could be, there are definitely chances of elite capture happening at such level, but it is okay, it is a path, it is a process. So we need to walk that path, we need to go through that processes. So is it possible for us to have a legislative oversight committees, especially on police brutality and such instances, so that there can be public hearings, open hearings that can be held, wherein the police chief, be it the SP or the DGP, are questioned by our elected representatives. Who else will question them? They are appointed officials, and the elected people have to question them. And they have to, that is how the legislature is supposed to function. The legislature is supposed to be the oversight mechanism for the executive. What we did instead, we created one more oversight committee, which is National Human Rights Commission, National This Commission, that is, which is again executive. They are again appointed officials. So legislature didn't want to do its job. So it said, okay, let's make committees, different committees. And then it hardly matters.
because we all want to be, we are all officers at one level or the other, we all want to keep good terms with each other, nothing happens there. Whereas if those oversight, accountability, ensuring accountability, those mechanisms were kept back with the legislature, which is their primary, one of the primary functions of legislature, we would be seeing a little more of an anger, because then they know if you put pressure, at least the legislature will have to take cognizance of it and do something about it. So these are certain solutions also we need to work on it, whether it's possible to have a legislative oversight committee, especially the company policing, whether is it possible to have at least a Thana level or a police station level civil society led committees. It's not to interfere in the day-to-day function, but at least as where a person can go with a complaint and say that, okay, this is something. I was in Dadra Nagar, holding a police PCs are there, supposed to be there in every state. Not every state has announced it, and even when it is functioning, it is not functional. I don't think even in Dadra Nagar Haveli people knew that I was heading a police complaint authority. So that is the, because it is again official. I as an officer would not want to take a fight with an SP, because we have to work together on so many instances. Why would we want to fight? That is not how system is supposed to function. So taking those accountability back to the legislature of executive is one of the things that we need to do, and also ensuring transparencies and accountable local level accountabilities at various levels, at the Thana level or at the district level, is also another thing that we need to explore on this aspect. Whereas we also don't know the solution. We also, how many of our universities run studies and come out with solutions on police brutality? How many of our universities have done studies even on the migrant crisis that we have had? How many of our universities have done an honest study on the impact of, let's say, demonetization? Our spaces of learning, our spaces of academic research, our spaces of thoughts, fresh thoughts, they are also highly constricted, very constrained spaces. I remember going to one of the IIMs and asking them, you are a premier institute, how many of you thought that demonetization was good? Everybody said, no, none of us thought demonetization was good. And I asked, how many of you wrote about it? Nobody. So if professors and students of IIM do not write something as serious as a policy mistake as that, how will the policy makers know? Assume that it was all done in good faith. Okay? How will the policy makers know? So that is again a space where students, academics, research, they need to be more honest to their own thoughts, their own views. It cannot be the case that, I often repeated this, there are only one kind of traitors. They are the ones who think things are not good, and they even then decides to keep silent for their own good, because they are keeping themselves above everything else. Those who think the government and everything is good and giving support is fine, because at least they honestly think everything is good. Those who think it is not good and are ready to raise voice, they are also doing for the nation only. But for those who think it is wrong and then trying to keep silence, then it is knowing that, knowingly something bad is happening, and it is in your capacity to at least express about it. Position to write something about it. You are in a position to influence certain minds about it. And if you decide not to do it for your own good, then you are putting yourself above everybody else. And, it's a harsh word to say, but yeah, maybe then you are the Deshdrohi. So I'm running out of time now. It's already 8:34.
Yes, sir. We are about to end. Thank you so much, sir. Now I hand over the stage to Meenakshi for delivering the vote of thanks, after which the session will come to a close. Thank you so much, sir. Meenakshi, you may have the stage.
Thank you, Kevin. Thank you so much, sir, for this very informative session. I would also take this opportunity to thank everybody at NotComs, the members and the organizing committee to make this webinar a success. I also would like to thank all participants for the same. I would also like to take this opportunity to announce our next webinar series, which is on the 4th of October with Dr. Kafil Khan. And we would be discussing the topic, police brutality. I hope this session was very informative to everybody and has in fact kept us thinking in all those moments where we've not reacted to something that we've seen wrong, and think about what we are going to do as responsible citizens in the future. I thank everybody and I wish everyone a great evening.